Hi everyone, I'm George Yaglis. I'm the director of the newly formed Institute for the Future at the University of Nicosia. And what I'll try to do in the next 10 minutes is try to share with you some of the vision that the university has on the future of our societies as we move from blockchain innovation to maturity of a number of technologies that we believe are going to be converging. They're going to be synergistic with each other, and they're going to create wholly new forms of applications that are going to have a huge disruptive potential in our world. So in this presentation, I'm going to focus on two of these technologies, artificial intelligence and the Internet of Things, and see how they could be combined with blockchain. So, three things that I think are the key messages out of this presentation. The first one is that we live at a truly historic timeline. We have a number of technologies, each of them being hugely disruptive on its own, but when they start reaching commercial maturity and they start being synergistic with each other, I strongly believe that these technologies will do nothing less than redefine the limits of what we think are possible in the in our world. And the common denominator of these technologies is that they are exponential in nature. From some point onwards, their growth is simply phenomenal, and we simply cannot keep up with this, and we need to be prepared for the disruption that is coming. Out of these technologies, as I said, we believe that the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence and distributed ledger technology, blockchain as we sometimes call it, are leading the way. And the reason that they lead the way is that they have many elements in common, although it doesn't seem like this in the beginning. The Internet of Things will create, is already creating, a hugely dense network of interconnecting devices that are going to be creating unprecedented amounts of real-time data as they are equipped with sensory abilities that allow them to monitor their surrounding environment and be alert to what is happening in real time. Then artificial intelligence is going to create a network of interconnected brains that are going to be able to process the data generated by the IoT and thereby triggering applications. And these applications are probably going to be using the blockchain as a decentralized web that allows us to enact on this data. So I'm going to tell more details about this in a moment, but the common denominator of these three things is data. And I believe we're entering, if we are not already there, an era in which data is going to dominate, and this will have huge implications for decision-making, the way businesses are run, the way we live our lives in the future. These exponential technologies are not only the three ones that I'm going to be focusing in this presentation. There are a number of others that share similar characteristics and are maturing at more or less the same timeline. These include robotics, augmented and virtual reality, additive manufacturing or 3D printing as most of us know it, nanotechnologies, materials, new materials, energy storage, autonomous vehicles, genetic engineering, and probably a little bit down the line, also quantum computing. So although in this presentation I'm going to focus on the three technologies on the top, at the Institute for the Future we're looking at the intersection of all these things and maybe some new ones that are going to be coming. And the reason that we look at all these things is that they present for the first time in history a very strong case for what we call the singularity. All these technologies are exponential in nature, and exponential technologies have a very, very specific characteristic. They can be really deceptive in the beginning, because exponential trends, when they start, they seem very slow, and people tend to underestimate their impact. Once we reach the knee of the curve and the exponent becomes really aggressive, then it is the point that these technologies start creating huge leaps in what they can deliver. We are seeing this in the last few years with artificial intelligence. For example, a technology that has existed literally since the 1950s, but only in the last 5 years it has started being so mature that it can provide the first glimpses of intelligence that we can equate or at least compare to our intelligence. So all these exponential technologies, as they are maturing together, are going to lead to what we think will be an era of intelligence explosion. And this era will in turn reach a point sooner rather than later. We expect this to be somewhere in the 2030s, so in the next 10 to 15 years, an era in which machines are going to be truly more intelligent than us. This is the singularity point, and it is very, very difficult to predict what is going to happen after that exactly, but we are sure that what is going to happen is going to fundamentally change our lives, our societies, and the way economies operate. And the reason of this fundamental transformation is the exponential nature of these technologies. Once machines become smarter than humans, they're not going to be slightly smarter than us. Very quickly, they're going to be orders of magnitude smarter than us. So our thinking that we might be able to somehow contain, control, or use to our advantage that intelligence is a very risky proposition. Because at some point or another, machines are going to be so much outsmarting us that we will not be able to contain what's going to happen after that. So the Internet of Things, as most of you should know, is a network that connects physical devices, essentially making them nodes in a computer network, equipping them with an IP address, interconnecting them. Most of these devices will have sensory abilities, so they will be able to monitor information in their surrounding environment. They will be running software, and they're going to be connected with each other. Why is this important? It's not important in its own right. So having machines communicate with each other is something that we've had for ages. I mean, this microphone communicates wirelessly with a number of devices in this room, so you can hear my voice. The really important thing for me is the fact that there are simply too many of them for the first time in history. We already live in a world in which the number of connected devices on the Internet of Things are more or less similar to the number of humans on Earth, and this is going to change very, very soon. By the year 2020, we expect more than 50 billion such connected devices. So the Internet of Things is going to create the very first technology in the history of humanity in which the relationship between machines and humans is going to be many to one. In the computer era, there was one computer for many of us. We now live in the mobile era where for the first time there are, you know, probably 5 billion mobile phones around the world, 7 billion people, so there's a more or less equivalence between devices of a specific technology and humans. Suddenly, we're going to find ourselves in a situation where machines will outnumber us by an order of magnitude, and they will continue to build a very, very dense communication network between them. So this is the first type of exponential technology that is reaching a critical level as we speak. Then artificial intelligence. Technically, AI is any computer science technique that allows machines to do things that we normally associate with human intelligence. So, for example, this could be recognizing patterns in images or in videos, recognizing or synthesizing speech, doing automatic translation, and so on and so forth. But the goals are really moving here. AI is not a static thing. A more accurate description of what AI is about, I think, is AI is whatever computers haven't done yet. So if we were discussing AI 20 years ago, playing chess or optical character recognition or things like that were research challenges, and they were classified as artificial intelligence problems. Nowadays, they are just everyday computing. Now, AI is about autonomous vehicles or robots or other forms of what we call general intelligence. But if history is any guide, in a few years' time, these things are going to be considered everyday computing too, and the challenges are going to be even more cognitively complex tasks. AI is still immature. It has not yet, maybe thankfully, reached a point in which we can seriously consider it as a real competitor to human intelligence in most everyday tasks. But as it happens with all exponential technologies, speed is picking up, and it's picking up exponentially, and it is, will be sooner rather than later by the time we see real disruption happening. And here is a point in which I have to disagree with Antonis Polymides and what he was saying earlier this morning, because I believe that although artificial intelligence is indeed centralized today, the next challenge that we're going to see is a move towards decentralized artificial intelligence. Nowadays, in order to train neural networks or machine learning algorithms, we need vast troves of data that can run only on centralized servers. As AI is maturing and as technology is progressing, we are bound to reach a point in which we can do this at the edges of the network. This is the reason why we see, at the same time, so much movement at both ends of the business spectrum when it comes to artificial intelligence. There's a huge landscape of startups and newly formed enterprises that are trying to pick up interesting subsegments of this area. And at the very same time, all the major players, realizing how disruptive this will be to their business model, are moving to AI. And finally, we have blockchain. We're in the blockchain conference, so thankfully I don't need to define blockchain to you as a shared, time-stamped, append-only, immutable, and cryptographically secured ledger of transactions, because this, believe me, when I'm talking to non-blockchain audiences, is the worst slide. But what is interesting for the purposes of this discussion is that blockchain creates a global network of trust. And this trust has two basic elements. One is that for the first time in history, we have new forms of money, wholly new forms of money. Let us for a moment stop thinking of Bitcoin or other digital currencies as simply digital versions of the types of currencies we have been used to work with. These are currencies that are programmable, so you can write programs in your money. In your money, you can attach code to money, like you can attach a picture to an email, we can attach code to money. And this code will undoubtedly in the future at some point instruct money where and when to move based on the fulfillment of certain conditions. So this money, on top of being programmable, it will be active. Up to now, we have had only passive money. Money is sitting in my pocket, sitting on my bank account, waiting for an explicit command to do something. Money of the future is going to be active. They're going to be determined for themselves where and when they should be doing something, hopefully for their owner. But blockchains also create new forms of contractual relationships. Contracts that are self-executable, immutable, censorship-free, and self-enforceable running on a blockchain. And the combination of these things create a very interesting form of new type of internet. An internet that might be perfect for machines. So one of the basic tenets that we have at the Institute for the Future is that the convergence of these exponential technologies is going to create a world in which machines are going to be interconnected in vastly dense networks, IoT. They're going to be able to be smart, AI, and they're going to be able to engage in contractual relationships and pay each other for services that they assign to each other through the blockchain. So we see the future, the technology stack of the future, as something that consists at the bottom layer of IoT, a very dense network of tens of billions and later possibly hundreds of billions of interconnected devices, each with both sensory abilities that allow them to understand what's going on around them and maybe with actuating abilities that allow them to take action based on real-time signals from their environment. Then AI is going to create what I call mini-brains, brains at the edges of the network, so each of these machines with embedded sensors are going to be intelligent machines, at some point maybe even more intelligent than us, and blockchain will function as the payment and settlement layer for commerce to be done between these machines. So We see an era dominated by machine-to-machine commerce, and this is the type of decentralized future that we're thinking. Blockchains will be creating a layer of trust on computer networks. We have discussed a lot in the blockchain community how this will alone remove middlemen, but I'm here to tell you that if you couple it with IoT and AI, it will not only remove middlemen, it might conceivably even remove men from the equation. And if we start thinking of an era in which machines are going to be able to do commerce with each other on an IoT substrate layers based on AI capabilities and paying each other for services that they assign to each other through blockchain, sooner rather than later, we're going to have autonomous economic agents emerging. Basically, machines are going to enter the economic landscape and are going to be able to do business with us and business with each other. Suddenly, the distinctions in e-commerce are not going to be B2C or B2B. It's going to be human-to-machine or machine-to-machine commerce. And again, if history is any guide, when machines start entering an era, people tend to become marginalized. See what's happening in the stock market now with high-frequency trading algorithms and bots. And at some point, we even envisage a future in which this will be changing the whole structure of industrial organization. Maybe the concept of a corporation, as we think about it today, is going to become obsolete. We're going to have businesses that will not have people. They're going to be humanless corporations, maybe only their shareholders. They're going to exist only as intelligent machines or as computer code running on the cloud, doing business, generating profits, and distributing the dividends of these profits to their human owners. So, concluding, we have launched the Institute for the Future to explore this hypothesis, the hypothesis that we're entering an era in which technological change will cause a huge and rapidly accelerating disruption in our societies. We're focusing on all the exponential technologies we've discussed. Blockchain is obviously the area where we're more advanced. We're working a lot on AI, IoT, and augmented virtual reality at the moment, with other things coming on. Our goal is to bring together business, academia, and policymakers, and generate an informed debate that would allow us to prepare ourselves for these coming changes. We're working across the school and departments of our university, and we're also working with our both corporate, academic, and institutional members. I'm not in a position at the moment to announce names, apart from a couple of announcements that have already been made. For example, you might have heard about our collaboration with Ripple, but in the coming months, we will launch a vast network of both corporate and academic members, and I invite each and every one of you that might be interested in joining that network to come and find me afterwards so that we can discuss how we can make this possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, George, for sharing your vision with us. I'm sure that you have stimulated very interesting and potentially great questions from the audience. So, any questions?
My name is George Gandzias. I'm from Hellenic Copenhagen University. And it was very interesting, all this vision you're going to you sharing with us. The thing is, at the moment, artificial intelligence has been in Toronto. Artificial intelligence already exists, and already actually we have progress on that issues, because they can speak with professors, and they can exchange ideas, they can use it as a chess player machines and all this stuff. And this is where I'm puzzling, actually, about the blockchains. If the artificial intelligence is going to move to that stage, and the artificial intelligence actually they're programming at the moment, and they make programs. Therefore, when you're speaking about decentralized, I have a bit of a question mark on that, because you have to centralize or regulate in order for human beings to exist in this computer-to-computers transactions. And this is the big issue about cryptocurrency, about all these issues economic, because we are moving the era. We're going to another stage. And all these issues about cryptocurrency and blockchains are coming from the old era. And artificial intelligence is here. It's not the future. In 2020 or 2025, things are going to be here with the machines. I would like to have your views about that, because we speak about future, and this is the future for me. Thank
okay.
you.
Thank you very much. I will share just one, some food for thought for you to ponder later. I agree that some of the technologies exist today, and they are mature enough. And that's why we have started thinking what the next move will be when these technologies will start to converge. What is interesting to note macroscopically is that this type of change is not going to be frictionless. There's going to be huge friction both between the old world and the new world, because this disrupts the current status quo dramatically. And there's going to be huge friction even within the communities that are supporting the change. See what's happening in the cryptocurrency sub-communities and the heated wars and debates between them. Because people, companies, governments, institutions are realizing that we are talking about a change of the rules of the game, and everyone wants to position themselves as, you know, best as they can for the emerging new world. I cannot, you know, I wish I could predict the future. I can tell you that these things are going to happen, but I'm sure that any thinking that I'm making at the moment on how these things are going to materialize is going to prove very simplistic. If I was here before you on 1994 talking about the next new thing, which was the internet back then, I would have been able to predict e-commerce, but I would never have been able to predict social networking or microblogging on Twitter or Airbnb or Uber or things like that. Every time we have a paradigm change in technology, the interesting thing is not migrating what we have been doing into the new technology, but doing wholly new things. And this is going to cause friction. I'm sure that when I said that we live at historical times, I'm not sure if we are lucky or unlucky to be living in these times, because I foresee a future of great social disruption, and some of the things that are happening in the global political landscape in the last 10 years or so are a direct result of this type of changes, because people are feeling uncertain about their future, they're feeling insecure, they don't understand these types of changes, and in the process they try to blame people or elements of society that they are not to blame.
Do you have time? One more question?
It's up to you.
Yeah, just one more question.
My question is how quantum computing will affect your vision of the future.
Okay, quantum computing, as I said, is probably the only one of these 12 technologies that we are focusing on that is still quite immature. I have heard about quantum computing since I was an undergraduate student, so many, many years ago. And still, we now have commercial quantum computers. They're very, very expensive and they can do very little, but there is nothing to suggest that they're not going to materialize at some point in the future. Probably this will be a few decades down the line for any sort of meaningful application. Hopefully, by the time this happens, some of the technical challenges that we have today, like, for example, securing SHA-256 or other forms of digital signatures in cryptographic systems, be that for digital currencies or others, are going to have migrated to quantum computing resistant algorithms anyway. But I really don't know. This is one of the uncertainties about the future that makes our research work even more challenging and even more important. Thank you very much.